gents, and morning, ladies and gents, and thanks for joining us in this ad hoc bond webinar we're hosting today. I'm Mayer Kutsia. I'm joined by the head of the bonds desk at Prescient, Reza Ismail. And our topic today is capitalizing on bond opportunities without being caught short. And the reason why we decided to host this webinar is really twofold. We believe there's a great opportunity in bonds, to invest in bonds, and that's the capitalize on the bonds opportunity. And the reason for that is our systematic evidence-based process is free of human biases. We look at the data, we look at the information, and we construct our portfolios and our positioning around that. So we are not influenced directly by fears of global inflation or the war in Ukraine. We will position the portfolio where we believe the opportunity sits. And why we say without the fear of being caught short is our flexible mandate in our flexible bond fund is quite unique in our market, in the sense that we target the best of bonds and cash over rolling 3-year periods. So when you invest as an investor in our bond fund, you are not married to bonds. We will ride out that opportunity in the bond market. And when that opportunity disappears, or when the risk to be invested in bonds is perceived too high, we will manage the duration down. So currently we are positioned at the tail end of the curve with high duration in the portfolio. Our yield is north of 10%. So it offers that great opportunity, but you can rest assured that should that opportunity materialize, the portfolio will be de-risked and there will be ample time to switch to something where the expected future return is better, it's more opportunistic. But one can also consider blending the bond fund with something like our income provider fund. And that will in effect just dilute some of the potential volatility in the bond fund with a stable yield in the income fund. So if the income fund currently sits with a forward yield of around 7%, bonds around 10%, just north of 10%, one can construct a portfolio in a combined manner, offers a very attractive yield, but with a muted exposure to the volatility that bond market can potentially provide. So also just consider that when you listen to Reza's story and the way he's gonna position bonds. Now, we wanted to position our process and just take you through the way we look at bonds to try and understand where we potentially are different from our peers in the market. So we hope you'll find it interesting. It's going to give you a good insight how we view these things. And Reza is very knowledgeable in this area. But please feel free to ask questions that I can pose to him at the end of the session. Hopefully, we'll be done by 10:45. So sit back and enjoy. And thanks, everybody. And thanks, Reza. Over to you.
Thank you. And good morning to all of our virtual audience, as it were. And it's always a pleasure to be able to address you. And basically, to make the most of our time over here, I'm going to quickly just dive in and share my screen. And I hope you can see that. And what you should be seeing in front of you is a dial of some sort. So, what we generally want to describe to you is that our systematic process, as Mayer alluded to, tries to take the kind of emotive and decision-making out of the science completely. In other words, there are a set of well-documented behavioral shortcomings that lead to suboptimal investment decision-making, and we try to minimize that. We try to take it completely away from the equation. And how do we do that? Essentially, we have what is known as our multi-factor system, and what you can see there is that it's really predicated on four main factors. The one relates to valuations, the other one to economics, the other one to financial conditions, and the other one to sentiment. Now, for example, there's like an age-old adage that says that, you know, you should maybe in the bond world, you should try and buy bonds when yields are high and sell bonds when yields are low. Now, there's nothing unreasonable about that approach, but essentially, if you think about what you're doing then, you are effectively championing a single factor, and that factor is valuations, because the only thing that you're using to make an investment decision is valuations. Now, whilst we don't think that approach is unreasonable, but what we do find is that the approach can be outperformed by including other factors that are not specifically related to valuation. So for example, by including economics as a factor, by including financial conditions as a factor, by including sentiment as a factor, you can achieve a superior investment performance than if you included just valuations on its own. All of these factors then have sub-factors, and I'm not going to go into all of them. I just wanted to give you a general feel for how we initially make investment decisions based on the aggregation of these four meta factors, which in turn have sub factors. And at the moment, what you can see is that the dial is in the position of being strong overweight, right? You know, so what that really says is that you should position your funds, or the stance that you should generally have is that of one of maximum active duration, given that the dial is in strong overweight. Now, what I'm going to take you through now is essentially our multi-step process with regards to how we actually put a bond portfolio together. And in so doing, I will make sporadic reference back to that original dial, and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. You'll quickly get a feel of what we're trying to say. Okay. So step one in bond construction, and you'll find this, across the academic landscape or in terms of practitioner best practices, that step one in a bond portfolio construction process is the duration call. The duration call is singularly the most important call that you can make. So, and why this is, you know, will become apparent in just a few sentences. If you think about the yield curve, then we know that the yield curve can essentially, change in three main ways. Okay, you can either have a parallel shift up or downwards, or you can have what's called here a twist, in other words, a change in the sloping of the yield curve, or you could have some curvature or butterfly effects. Now, why we say the duration call is the most important call that you can make is that we have statistical evidence to prove, and I'll take you through this in just a second, but we have statistical evidence to prove that the main way in which the yield curve moves is this first component, is that, in other words, is a parallel shift up or downwards. And how I can prove that is that we do have a lot of very systematic, very quantitative tools at our disposal. And we think that itself is a differentiator. But if we look at a very commonly used statistical technique known as principal components analysis, we can say that approximately 94% of the variability that the yield curve experiences is due to changes in level, right? The overall level of the curve changing up or down, okay? So that means that the only way one bond can outperform another bond is by virtue of its duration characteristics, you know? So in other words, a bond with higher duration will outperform in an environment in which the general level of the curve compresses, i.e. moves down, and vice versa, right? So that's why the duration call is singularly the most important call that you can make, because we know that the main kind of variability experienced by the yield curve is changes in levels up or down, as explained by the first principal component. 94% of the variability is explained by changes in level, right? So going back to our storyboard, the first question that we've got to get right is this duration question. We know that the yield curve is actually going to move up or down, okay? Given that we know that the general way is it up or down, which one of the two is it? Is it up or down? Which then links back to the original dial which I showed you, i.e. this one. And this dial basically says that on the basis of statistical and econometric evidence, when this dial is in the strong overweight, this tells you that in general, whenever the score has been in this dark navy blue, strong overweight, the general direction of the level of the yield curve is downwards. So we know that it's mainly going to change up or down. And this dial basically says that the direction of change will be downwards. In other words, from this point onwards, you can expect a material compression of the overall level of the curve downwards. And now it should be quite clear how important that duration question is. So this one is saying, observe a stance of maximum active duration, based on the aggregated score, right? Let me move on to step number two. Step number two in the process, number one, as I told you, was a duration call. Step number two has various names in the industry, but basically it can be called the term premium call or the twist call or the convexity call. But really what we're trying to do here is we're trying to say, okay, for a given duration stance, right? Do you want to have a picture like the one I'm circling here, you know, where you have a lot of concentrated maturities at a single point or a common point around the yield curve? Or do you want to have something where you have almost like this barbell shape, where you have some exposure at the long end, some exposure at the very front end? You know, which one of the two? Both of these configurations have the same duration signature, but they only differ with regards to its dispersion or its exposures along the yield curve. So which one of the two do you want? And we've got a number of other you know, tools that we can use to inform you know, this view. So if I go to our optimizer, and as I say, we've got a lot of quantitative tools at our disposal. So what we can then do is we can say which one of those two. I know that the modified duration of the ORB is 6.61 years. I can then say, let's plug in 8.61 years to give an active duration of two. Let's say I want to maximize total return. I click on submit, and an optimizer sort of does the work for us. And it will basically spit out for us the configuration that is optimal given this duration stance, right? And basically what it's saying is now, the optimal configuration, you know, given a specified duration stance, is to invest in the 2048 alongside a combination of 2032. So the bulk of it, 83% in a 2048 and the remaining part in a 2032. But I'm just merely proving to you and just showing you that in step two of our process, where we're trying to configure for a given duration stance, where we want how the general portfolio shape to look, either a barbell or a bullet, we've got a quantitative tool to assist us with that process, okay? Step number three that we do in terms of the, I've taken you through step number one, step number two, and now we come to step number three, is that once you've made a duration call and you've decided on the general portfolio shape that you want to effect given that duration stance, you now might want to say, okay, right, do I want to get that duration from the nominal or the linker market? Remember, you can get duration from nominal bonds or inflation-linked bonds. Which one of the two do you prefer, or which one of the two are optimal at a point in time? And we've got another quantitative tool to help us make that decision in a very systematic fashion. So if we go to the section which we call real versus nominal, and let's just look at the 25-year area, because that's the area of the curve that I've just been making a case for. What we know is that a long-end bond is trading at a yield of about, call it 10.5%. Along a similar tenor, a similar dated linker bond is trading at a real yield of 4.1%. If you subtract the two, you get an implied break-even rate. Many people refer to break-evens as inflation expectations. This is not entirely correct, because we know break-evens contain an inflation risk premium. So we need to estimate that econometrically and then subtract that from your break-even. So you get to basically a figure of around 5.3%, and that is telling you how much inflation compensation you're actually getting in a nominal bond, okay? So what do we measure this 5.3% against, okay? So we look at this line, right? So what this is saying is that when this line, when the spread that we get, which is at 5.3% now, as I just illustrated, when the spread is north of this 5.5% line, you want to have a tactical preference for nominal bonds. When the spread is south of this 5.5% line, you want to have a tactical preference for linkers. Now you might say, what's so special about this 5.5% line? Why don't you use 4.5%? Because that is the midpoint that the Saab tries to target in terms of its inflation band, right? So what we know is that if you look a little bit deeper into the quarterly projection model, you see that the Saab will allow themselves approximately 100 basis points of latitude before it will initiate a hike as far as the model is concerned. So instead of saying 4.5%, we say 4.5% plus 100 basis points or plus 1% to get to 5.5%. And we use that as the litmus test as to whether we want to have a tactical preference for nominals or linkers. Early on in the month, when the nominal curve sold off in a quite a pronounced fashion, we had a tactical preference for nominals and we sold out of linkers completely. at the moment now the spread is showing something different, and we're gradually going to be moving from nominals and into linkers. And this is one of the other the perks or the benefits of having the flexible mandate with a systematic tool at your disposal, because we use this tactical shifting between nominals and linkers to great effect. And this has been one of the sources of value add that we've demonstrated over the past 18 months, right? So that is step number three. I just want everyone to stay with me. I've explained step number one, which is the duration call. Step number two, which is the convexity call or the term premium call. Step number three is a nominal versus linker call. And step number four is we also consider sort of credit and currency ideas in the mix. So what I'd like to then show you also as part of the tools that we've got on our quantitative portal, which obviously gets updated in real time, or at the very least today as of yesterday's close. I just want to illustrate to you how we think about credit. So what we've got here in the blue dashed line, that is the sovereign nominal fitted curve, that's the RSA bond curve, and the different colored dots that you see or potential credit opportunities that you can potentially take. Now, what should be visually obvious is that, if you are interested in positioning at the long end, and hopefully we've already made a case as to why that is so, but let's say you're interested in the long end, what you can see is that you don't really have a lot of options with regards to the credit buffet here at the long end. You can see that credit opportunities are mostly localized around the front end of the curve. And that makes sense, because if you are an issuer of credit or you're raising capital via credit paper, and you are corporate, obviously you'd want to issue here at the front end where yields are low, or you'd want to issue paper that is referenced to JIBAR, which by historical standards is low. And that makes perfect sense if you look at the kind of credit opportunities that are very, very, very localized here at the front end of the curve, not really any credit opportunities at the back end, right? So what I'm really saying here is that if you are maximum bullish duration and you like the long end of the curve and you want that barbell shape that I was alluding to, then there's not a lot of credit opportunities that you have to choose from, okay? Another important and I would say slight misconception about and one of the bullet points around this webinar was this idea of diversification, right? You know, how do you think about diversification in the context of a yield curve, right? Most people try to import ideas, from equity portfolio management onto the bond space and think that there's a direct correlate for that, but that's actually not the case. In other words, so what I'm saying is, many people ask us, and if you look through the portfolio, you'd see that we've got very outsized exposure to the 2048 bond. Now, they might say, why are you investing so much in the 2048 bond? Why don't you invest a little bit in the 2044 or maybe a little bit in the 2040 as opposed to investing only in the 2048 bond? But principal components analysis or the kind of analysis I was showing you in the beginning helps us to answer that question, right? And what do I mean by this? Let's just go to principal components again and look at this chart. And what is it really saying? It's saying that 94% of the variability in the yield curve is explained by changes in the level of the curve, which means that 94% of the time, all the bonds on the term structure, 94% of the time, are going to experience price changes in the same direction. 94% of the time, all the bonds on the yield curve are going to experience price changes in the same direction. So there's actually no diversification benefit then that you actually get by moving to several points on the yield curve as opposed to just investing in the one. This is a statistical way to just dispel a common misconception. But if you don't really want to get too much involved in the PCA, let me show you a little bit of an easier way to conceptualize that. Let's just look at this correlation matrix. So if we focus our attention on the back end, let's say all the bonds from a 2040 onwards, a 2040, a 214, a 2044, and 2048 onwards, right? So I'm interested in the back end of the curve. You can see how massively correlated each of these bonds are with each other. For example, a 2048 and a 2044 and a 2040 bond are 99.7% correlated, in which means that statistically speaking, there's an extremely negligible benefit that you can get by combining a 2048 and 2040 bond as opposed to just investing in a 2048 bond alone, right? 99.7% correlated. So some people say, why don't you just invest equal amounts in each of these bonds? Well, you could, but not in the name of diversification, because you get no true diversification benefit to speak of, given the correlation table that I've just shown you. Obviously, if things change and we move to the front end of the curve, then possibly you do have diversification in the sense of the classical sense. You know, you maybe have balance sheet diversification. Maybe you're investing in a growth point and a Mercedes-Benz, two different issuers that may have different balance sheet risk. And then, yes, surely, then you can speak of diversification, that one of them might blow up and go to zero while the other issuer remains intact. So then you can have diversification. But what I'm speaking of is on the assumption that you're at the long end, and on the assumption that you are only considering sovereign bonds, because I've already showed you there's no credit alternatives at the long end, you don't get a diversification benefit by investing in several long end bonds as opposed to only the 2048. So that is really our multi-step process and how we really sort of think about putting bonds together, right? You know, and I've essentially taken you through this four-step process. And hopefully it will make some kind of sense to you. As I said, just to reiterate and to recap, make sure everyone's on board here. The main way the yield curve is going to change is up or down. So the way that bonds then outperform is via duration. If only I had a crystal ball that could tell me, is that direction going to be up or down, given that I know it's going to be a parallel change. Turns out I don't quite have a crystal ball, but I've got something nearly as good, which is this portal score here, that says that when this thing is in the navy blue Reza, then you should try, then the general expectation is that the direction of change will be downwards, i.e. yield compression. Now, how do I have such conviction in that? Is because, not because I think it will work, but because we've tested this statistically and econometrically. So if you look at the distribution of a 252-day forward return, every time this dial has been in the strong overweight section, it has been followed up by a 252-day, i.e. That's a period of a year, if we exclude weekends and public holidays on average, you can see that the return distribution lies to the right, you know, to the right of any other return distribution. The return distribution of the navy blue lies to the right, you know, of the other distributions. In other words, you genuinely do better if you take this symbol, if you take the score, and you really do position in a strong overweight active duration score, this return profile shows you that you genuinely do better. Obviously, I would have a problem statistically if I'm telling people to go active duration year when actually the return distribution is somewhere here, way on the left. But that's not the picture I see. I see that I genuinely am compensated for taking active duration when the score is in the strong overweight section. So hopefully I've given you a little bit of a window of insight into how we think about bonds as part of a multi-step process. One of the things that Meyer sort of mentioned in the beginning is that we try to take we try to separate two worlds. Okay. There's a common world that I would call the world of the journalistic narratives, right? It's very like the headline grabbing narratives, you know, it's very emotive and it tries to evoke sensitivities within its reader. That's almost the job of an emotive journalist, right? And then you have the world that is based on facts and data, okay? And that is the world that we prefer to dwell in. So for example, if you look at the most recent episode, right, with regards to the Russian invasion of the Ukraine, and I don't want to get too involved about, you know, the sort of the political side. It's obviously a terrible humanitarian episode. But what we say is, how do we think about that episode from an investment perspective, right? You know, and the way that we actually do that is that we don't look for our cues from headlines. We look for our cues in terms of trying to first identify what really drives asset prices. What set of factors really drive asset prices? And what we've come to is a parsimonious set or a small number of factors relating to valuations, economics, financial conditions, and sentiment. And so if you have an event like a geopolitical event, we've got to say, which of these four factors does that geopolitical event actually find currency in? In other words, where does it find its voice in? the common way that we would say is, okay, perhaps it leads to a tightening of financial conditions, or maybe it leads to stress in the banking sector, right? And let's just examine that, right? Let's just look at financial conditions. So I click on that section in the portal, and let's just look at something like, within financial conditions, I look at something like, if you just give it a moment to load, I look at something like credit spreads. So what can we see here, right? If we examine credit spreads, okay, credit spreads blow out at the time of COVID. That's generally expected. It was a wide-ranging global pandemic, right? But let's just look a little bit further. So this Ukraine invasion happened more or less, hit global markets more or less end of February, early March, that kind of thing. And we did see a little bit of a widening of credit spread, but not in a very pronounced manner, not in the kind of step change that we saw at the time of COVID, nothing like this. You know, it's a mere molehill compared to a Mount Everest over here. You know, so it's a very, very, very minor little blip relative to its long-term median with regards to credit spreads. So that's why we're saying that, and what this tells us is that despite a lot of media headlines about anarchy and about, you know, Armageddon type World War III scenarios, we try to say, let's shove that aside for a minute and let's look at, does that really find a voice in financial conditions? It does, but not in a very conspicuous manner. And that is what I'm trying to say with regards to the idea about putting data first and trying to ascertain what really drives asset prices and asking the question, has there been a step change in those things that really matter? Has there been a step change in financial conditions? Not really. There's been a little bit of a change, but not really, not in a very pronounced way. Has there been a massive change in sentiment? What this is saying is that a little bit of a change, but not in a very pronounced manner. And so when you can aggregate the investment decision in a data-centric fashion, I think you are in a very, very good place. You know, I think most of suboptimal decisions come about because you put emotion first. And you put framing and anchoring and those kind of very well-documented behavioral biases at the very front of your decision-making. That leads to suboptimal outcomes instead of putting facts and econometric evidence at the forefront, which is what we try to do, okay? So that is just a little bit on how the overall portal sort of comes together. One thing that I wanna address in sort of the final 10 minutes is, I think there's a lot of misconception about what can actually happen or what can go wrong when you are investing so much of your portfolio in a high conviction, concentrated manner in a single instrument. But let's just look at some scenarios over here. So what this is, we can tell you that, for example, I've got a list of bonds over here, which spans the term structure. And what I can say is that, let's just look at the 2048 bond, which is a sizable portion of the flexible bond portfolio. What this is saying, in the environment that yields do indeed shift in a parallel manner, 25 basis points lower or 0.25% lower, right? What are my components of return, right? You're going to get some components that relate to roll. So as the bond approaches maturity, it needs to price at par and you'll get a little bit of a return because of that. You get your coupon cash flow effect. In other words, you have legally specified coupons that occur on legally specified dates for this bond. And then you get the return component that is in respect of the interest rate shock that you get. In this case, it's a parallel shift downwards of the curve. So if that does materialize, you will know that the 2048 bond returns 13% and it outperforms any of the other bonds in the space over here. But one thing that people commonly worry about is that, what if you are wrong? In other words, what if you don't find a parallel shift lower? What if you actually get a parallel shift higher? And this scenario exactly looks at that case. The interesting thing here is that you don't actually break the buck, right? So even in the case that yields start off at 10.4%, let's just say, and experiences a 25 basis point sell-off. In other words, the curve gets cheaper, yield sell-off. You still return 8.5% over the next year. Now, why do you have that? You have that because with bond investment, you're not starting the race with zero in the bag, right? When you buy a bond, what you are effectively signing on for is that you are going to get this coupon cash flow yield come what may. In other words, I am starting the race with 10.5% in the bag already. And anything that can negatively happen from that point first needs to eat away at that 10.5% before I can start losing capital. So you find in a case that even if yields shift higher by 25 basis points, and I can show you for higher scenarios as well, but you don't then break the buck because yes, by all means, you take a hit with regards to the duration effect, 2.2%. But remember, you're starting off the race with 10.5% in the bag. So over the next year, you're still going to earn 8.5%, even in the bear scenario. And even the 8.5% is better than what near-term cash can offer. That's why whilst bond investment, will sometimes have short-term volatility, it actually takes quite a pronounced move for you to actually break the buck. In other words, earn a below zero return for you to lose on a long-dated bond, given that you're earning 10.5% via your coupon cash flow yield. So that is a very, very important part. And I can change this for different scenarios. Let's say we were talking about an interest rate decrease, and it's not 25 basis points, it's 50 basis points, which is not that much of a stretch now to imagine that it goes from like 10.4% to, let's say, 10. You will earn 15.4% on a 2048 bond. And that again outperforms any other bond on the term structure, right? So like I say, and like Maya alluded to in the beginning, one of the attributes of the flexible bond product is that the portfolio manager has got complete discretion as to where on the yield curve to move, right? You know, at the time, in the current context, based on our score that I keep alluding to in the beginning, we find there's a lot of value to be had in the yield curve. We feel that we say that our central expectation is that yields compress from these levels, and that's why we find value in the long end. However, if it were to be the case that things change, i.e., you maybe have a very pronounced hiking cycle from the SARB, and the front end of the curve starts to look more attractive, and you find that we want to take duration off the table, then that is something that the flexible bond product can do, right? You know, we can go. If this score, for example, by way of illustration, if this dial were to go to neutral or were to go to strong underweight, then because it's unconstrained with regards to duration, we can have a very, very aggressive underweight stance if conditions permit, if conditions dictate that it's actually the correct time to take duration off the table. And what we would do in an instance like that is we go again to our optimizer. And I know that the OB has a duration of 6.61. Let's say I wanted to only have neutral duration, so not a very aggressive overweight stance. I wanted to have a neutral stance. I could pop that into our optimizer, and you could see the kind of shape that it will then want. So instead of being very 2048 heavy, it's basically saying, take some of that 2048 exposure away, Reza, and put it into the 2032 bond, you look a lot more like the index. In fact, you will have exactly the index duration. If you look at this portfolio, exactly 6.61, but you'll have the return maximizing portfolio for all the duration. It says that invest in a 2032 bond and a little bit in a 2048. So what I'm simply trying to show you is that we have the quantitative tools at our disposal to effect a particular duration stance, given the dictates of this dial. We can move from the curve either way, up or down. And even let's do a more extreme example. If I were to say that all B duration is 6.61 and I only want a duration of 4, let's just say, we can also illustrate that via the optimizer. If you just give it a couple of seconds to run. Right, it's just doing its mathematics over here. And then you see that the optimal combination, if you only want a portfolio duration of 4, in other words, more or less like a 2.5 year active underweight duration, your optimal combination is R1 at 6 plus a 2030. So again, we have the tools at our disposal. Should this dial move into strong underweight territory, we'd know exactly what to do from an optimal portfolio perspective. And that is exactly the benefit of having the flexible mandate. We unconstrained with regards to duration, we unconstrained with regards to sectors, And we also make you know very judicious use of credit as the opportunities arise. And if we are interested in the front end of the curve, as I showed you, you saw all those dots earlier, you know, then we would have a much stronger credit footprint should we want to be interested in the front end of the curve. So I think I'm going to pause there and maybe ask if there's any questions, or happy to take other questions. And I think I'm doing reasonably okay with the time that was given to me. I hope it didn't come across as rushed in any sense. But I really wanted to cover three areas, and that was taking you through our multi-step process, taking you through the way that we assimilate the global macro environment, and then basically taking you through some things with regards to risk management and some common misconceptions with regards to when do you actually break the buck when you're investing in a long-term bond. So I'm happy to take any questions now. Maybe some of the other hosts can coordinate that for me, but I'm happy to take some questions from the audience at this point.
Thanks, Reza. Maybe just one point I want to touch on is within our systematic process and looking at our bond positioning, where we're currently strong overweight, looking at the underlying components of valuations, economics, financial conditions, sentiment. I think one point that maybe you can just stress again is the sensitivity of this dial to changes in the environment. And maybe by way of an example, if we look at that line chart below it, it shows you through time how this dial has changed. But maybe pick a spot or two and illustrate, because this happens real time, illustrate why this thing has moved so significantly, so that the audience can get a feel for what one for how it's positioned.
Right. So for example, let me and this obviously gives us a chance to toggle the dates, but let me rewind to, let's say, the beginning of 2020, right? Let me just show you what actually happens over here. So if we can all cast our minds back, actually, what actually happens here is that this is January 2020, and obviously the scaling now is only showing the dates as of that point, right? But this is showing you that at that point, we are approximately at neutral duration. In other words, you see the overall score here hovering around zero, which meant that we would have had a neutral-ish duration, okay? And then what actually happens then is that COVID happens more or less around this time, right? Which was sort of March or April of 2020. Now, let me tell you then what actually happens here in terms of valuations is that if you can think about it, during the COVID episode, yields sell off massively, right? It sells off massively. So if you only used valuation as your metric for making an investment decision, you would have actually gone maximum overweight at that time, right? But unfortunately, you had certain things working against you, right? That would have made that not an optimal time to add duration. Because at that time, what classically happened was that you had high yields. In other words, your valuation was all in the navy blue, but financial conditions were so dire because credit spreads blew out, funding pressure blew out, and the cross-currency basis blew out, which we can all measure in real time, alongside very poor sentiment with regards to emerging markets. So what happened is that if you simply added duration at that time, you would have suffered that leg up when yields continue to sell off in the face of already high starting yields. In other words, if you thought yields were high at 11 and you started to buy at 11, financial conditions and sentiment works against you, and then you suffered that leg up from 11 to, let's say, 12.3, where yields actually maxed out. Whereas if you actually kept duration neutral-ish and only then added duration later on that year in October, which was a couple of months later only, but it made a world of difference, then at that point yields were still high, but then what you had on your side was supportive financial conditions and supportive sentiment, along with the economic side as well. So this actually gives you quite a good indicator of when is the optimal time to add duration and not to be actually quite early on the jump, right? And that is almost the danger of making an investment decision based on valuations alone, right? There's nothing stupid about that, but it's simply it is outperformed by a portfolio management system that takes other factors also into account in making a decision. And that actually paid off handsomely to us. We added duration at that time, which was early October, when the other factors were also supportive, and it resulted in massive alpha for us sort of in the months to come. So that is like a very good illustrative example of how we use this and how we have used this in previous episodes of stress to ultimately add value for clients.
Yeah, Reza, thanks. I mean, that again illustrates that mantra of risk management that underpins our process always, is to kind of look at the balanced approach and ensure that, you know, you're not gung-ho on one factor. But maybe tying into that is, you know, the concept of max drawdowns, does that feature in the process at all?
Let's picture a product can, right? The product can for this thing basically says that over a rolling 3-year period, right, you will outperform the term structure. In other words, you will be better than, so you look at the term structure, what has been the best asset on the entire term structure over the past 3 years, and flexible bonds tries to do better than that, or has proven to do better than that over time if you look at the history, right? But the other side of the can, or sort of the short fine print or the caveat, the provisos, is that that performance will not be in a straight line. And we find that sometimes, right, you will have volatility in absolute terms and in relative terms. In other words, you have absolute volatility in the sense that you can have drawdowns relative to the ORBI from time to time. But that sets you up. That sows the seeds for future outperformance. You must be able to tolerate somewhat short periods in which volatility is high, drawdowns in relative and absolute terms. You will look very different to the ORBI in relative terms, and in absolute terms you might suffer drawdowns, but that is basically us sowing the seeds and taking position in an undervalued part of the curve that we think, based on statistical history, will outperform in the future. And that is exactly what happened. So if you look at that kind of graph, when we started to add duration in early September, October in 2020, what we found that what was by the next February, we were already outperforming. So yes, drawdowns and having relative volatility to the ORBI is part and parcel of the signature. I don't for 1 minute doubt that. But what we're trying to say and what we're asking of investors is that you simply have a long-term orientation, right? You don't start checking your portfolio every day or every week, that kind of thing. You know, a little bit of volatility is part and parcel of this product, but you do achieve superior long-term outcomes. I mean, and that is proven by the performance record of flexible bonds. So I'm not trying to shy away from it. I'm not trying to say that there will not be volatility, there will not be drawdowns, but it is only via that drawdowns and via that high conviction positioning that you lead to meaningful future outperformance. And that is really the selling point about this product.
Yeah, I think also what we need to keep in mind is, you know, the fund risk, the flexible bond fund risk, which you talk to now, and the client risk in his portfolio. And as I mentioned up front, one way to mitigate that is to control your exposure to the bond fund. And if you get a very risk-averse client, blend it with an income fund or a portion of the income fund that you feel comfortable with, and you've got a client with a more longer term view that appreciates the opportunity in the bond market, have a higher exposure to the bond fund, because the return expectations are certainly very attractive in terms of inflation at this point in time. Well, I think that's it for us now. We kind of targeted 10:45 and we're pretty much there. So Reza, thanks very much for your time, and all our audience, especially thanks for your time and joining us on this lovely Wednesday morning.
I see there are, in terms of the Q&A, I'm not sure if those are comments or whatever, but I do see that there are some audience questions. I'm not sure if you've already addressed them via your questions to me, but if we could maybe just take a scan in terms of maybe there's an outside question that I haven't addressed.
I have to relate them. There is one more question around your 25 bps shift scenario.
Yes.
That potentially the 2035 and 37 could be more attractive than 48 if you combine the higher and lower scenarios. What is the basis of the optimizer allocating to the 2048 bond? You know, is it slightly higher return in the lower shift scenario? Does it matter that it's only 25 bps difference? in the return for 2037 return? Where's the bigger difference?
That's a great question.
That question.
Yeah, let's just go there, right? Yeah. You know, so what we actually find is that if we go year, right? Let's go this. Okay. So in the 50 situation, and I know exactly where the question is coming from, right? You know, so in the 50 basis point scenario, and generally when you increase the size of the shock, and we're doing it in increments of 25 over year, roughly, so 25, 50, 75, and 100. But the bigger your shock in a direction that is favorable to you, obviously it rewards your duration and convexity attributes of the longer dated bonds more. And that's why the 2048 sort of outperforms, okay? But one thing that we want to almost like point out, right, is that let's just look at the scenario where you actually don't have any increase at all, right? So this is the no shift scenario. So what we can actually see here is that precisely as the questioner asks, if you look at the 2048 in a no shift scenario, in other words, if yields stay exactly as they are, right? Over the next year, you actually find that the 2035 returns 11.1, 2037 just 11, and 2048 only 10.7, right? You know, one of the things is that we're acutely aware of this, and we separated out into different components of the return here. So if we just follow closely, you'll see that the 2035 and the 2037 has quite a meaningful return from this capital gain effect of roll. So what this really means is that it's 40 basis points in the case of a 2037, at 65 basis points in the case of a 2035, but it's zero in the case of a 2048. Now, why do you have that? Is because the 2048 is actually at a part of the curve in which you actually don't have meaningful roll at all. It's in a flattish part of the curve at the very back end. Whereas the belly of the curve is almost quite near the steepest part of the curve, not exactly the steepest, but near the steepest, in which you get a component of the return that is attributable to roll. In other words, what this calc is saying is that if the yield curve stays exactly the same shape, which is a very dangerous assumption, but basically for the purposes of the mathematics, if the yield curve stays exactly the same shape over the next year, the 2035 and the 2037 will roll down to a different cohort, and in so doing, will get the capital gain effect from that roll of 65 basis points in the case of a 2035 and about 40 basis points in the case of a 2037. That part of the return is not guaranteed. That part of the return. So if we almost like normalize for that, right, then the difference between that and what the 2048 does, which gets nothing from roll at all. And it's not an unreasonable assumption, but I'm simply saying that it is not an absolute given that this component of return will actually come to pass. Unlike, for example, your coupon cash flow yield, which is a mathematical certainty because it's coupon divided by the all-in price that you pay upfront. So we just tread carefully with regard to this. I've just shown this in an illustrative manner, but it's not necessarily always a watertight mathematical case that you will get this coupon capital gain effect from roll, which are the big contributors to return from the 2035 and the 2037. Another angle to also look at this from is that, let's say you had a choice between investing only in the 2035s and 37s, or investing a little bit mostly in the 2048 and a near-dated bond. Then the 2048 plus a near-dated bond would have higher convexity, right? So what that means is, if you can just picture a situation, is let's just say yields start out at 10, move down to 10.5, back to 10, move up to 11, back to, you know, that kind of thing, and end up the same place that it started, right? The benefits of convexity can actually outperform the actual carry benefits that you get from these belly bonds. It's a little bit of a technical diversion over here, but rest assured that we have looked at all of this in a holistic manner, and that really sits behind our ultimate choice of positioning over here. I hope that answered the question a little bit.
Absolutely. Thanks, Reza. Just to conclude, I mean, hopefully the message that we got across was, as across all our products, we aim to offer the best of both worlds. Again, that blend between risk and return. Our flexible bond fund is on most of the lists available, and obviously directly for our Manco. Should you have any further questions, obviously feel free to contact us, contact your regional BDM. We are national. Contact myself, Mayer Kutsia, or Reza. We'd obviously always be very happy to respond. And with that, have a great day further, and enjoy the rest of the week. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys. Always appreciate the time.